Hello everyone, and welcome back to The Film Feast. My name is Sam Donchus, and I'm your host. Ever since I started The Film Feast, one of the most important elements I wanted to incorporate into the show was talking about all sorts of movies. Not just tentpole blockbusters, which has been a majority of the show thus far. I also want to talk about Best Picture contenders, and horror movies, and romance movies, and comedies. I want to talk about everything. And this episode features some news that I feel like is my first chance to put some variety into the show for a change. Many of you have probably heard of or been to the Alamo Drafthouse theater chain. Well, it turns out they also have a film distribution branch called Drafthouse Films, and they have the rights to several awesome movies such as Bullhead, Clown, Wake in Fright, and A Band Called Death. Admittedly, that's just most of the titles that I have seen from Drafthouse Films, but they have an immense library, just under 35 movies. But in this episode of The Film Feast, I want to highlight two specific movies under the Drafthouse Films banner. The first film is a feature-length documentary that came out last year. It's called The Act of Killing, and it's not just the best documentary of last year, it's one of the best documentaries of all time. I don't like to delve into hyperbole all that often, but trust me when I say that The Act of Killing is the real deal. The documentary is directed by Joshua Oppenheimer and premiered way back in August of 2012 to rave reviews. Ever since then, it's swept dozens of high-caliber film festivals and won several prestigious awards. And if all that isn't enough to convince you, I just have to suggest watching it yourself. It's on Netflix Instant, right there for your streaming convenience, but I do caution just jumping into it without knowing what you're getting into. One of the bigger reasons why I considered The Act of Killing to be such a groundbreaking and mind-blowing documentary is because of the horrific subject matter within. To put it simply, it will shake your entire notion of human nature to its core. The documentary focuses on the Indonesian killings of 1965 through 1966, in which over 500,000 people were killed in an anti-communist purge. In the center of all this were a couple of gangsters who were promoted from small-time crooks to being the leaders of one of the most destructive death squads in North Sumatra. The director, Joshua Oppenheimer, spends a majority of the film focusing on these men, under the guise of having them reenact their most gruesome killings on camera. This is where the film takes a turn for the weird and dark and almost surreal in a way, because these men are performing these reenactments in a very light atmosphere. They're laughing and joking because for them, this is what they did when they were teenagers. This is second nature for these guys. While in their later years, they have become a lot more separated from these killings, it's very much still a part of who they are. While the audience is just watching in absolute horror, because this is one of the worst things that could happen to a person is be a victim of a massive genocide. In the last 5 minutes alone of this film, I was absolutely shaken. The Act of Killing broke me. And while Joshua Oppenheimer has put together what I consider to be a masterpiece, he has a follow-up film coming up to The Act of Killing. It's called The Look of Silence. You could call this film a sequel, but I consider it to be more of a companion piece, because while it does focus on the same killings of 1965 through 1966, it flips the script and focuses on the victims. In The Act of Killing, you rarely ever heard from the side of survivors, so this will be a very intriguing look at that time period and the people who faced this harsh injustice head-on and were able to hopefully move on from it. Drafthouse Films' The Look of Silence is already screened at the Venice Film Festival, the Toronto International Film Festival, and the New York Film Festival, and it will hit theaters in summer of 2015. Seek out The Act of Killing. Whether you purchase it from Drafthouse Films or you just watch it on Netflix Instant, it will be an experience for you. And The Look of Silence is one of my most anticipated films of 2015. Foreign films, whether they be documentaries or narratives, allow me to see the world around me, and it alters my perception of everything in the process. One final note about Drafthouse Films, they are a fantastic and talented distribution company. From the one film of theirs that I do own, Bullhead, this whole package is so well put together. The slipcover is reversible, there's a 16-page booklet inside, and the special features are very well rounded out. In general, fantastic Blu-ray. I should own more of their stuff. One day I will. So that is it for this episode of The Film Feast. Here's a trailer for The Look of Silence. Go check it out. Let me know what you think in the comments below. Also, subscribe to the channel. Check out the Facebook page for the Film Feast. You can also find my Twitter and Letterboxd account. Links are in the D-box. And join me on the next episode where I will be talking about the actress in negotiations for the live-action remake of Ghost in the Shell. Thanks for watching. So I've been watching more TV and less movies. It's unfortunate, but it happens sometimes. So let's get started. The first show that I caught up on and finished is Star Wars The Clone Wars, the Cartoon Network show, not the original miniseries, which is a much better show in my opinion. This actually was canceled because of Disney buying Lucasfilm, and Cartoon Network had to ultimately cut it short. Eventually Netflix came in, licensed their remaining episodes that were basically finished development-wise, you know, for distribution, streaming. They called them, I think, the Lost Missions. I want to focus on his sci-fi side, because there have been a lot of rumblings about Prometheus 2 lately, and a lot of questions being asked. Capital of which is, why did they make the first one at all? A lot of people don't like that movie. I'm a little torn on it. I think it's okay. I love it visually. Its story kind of frustrates me. And I think the fact that they tried to anchor it so much into the Alien franchise ultimately weighed it down a good bit. But the other question being asked is Prometheus 2 going to happen at all? And is Ridley Scott going to direct it?